Him. Amen. The scripture says God is rich. Well, come on, I'm getting the scripture. Turn to Romans Romans 10. I want to just magnify. This is what I'm going to do. After we do a sufficient job of this, we're going to just see God work and heal so easy. I'm going to magnify His goodness. I'm going to get all these sad faces. Amen. I'm going to work on these sad faces. Oh, praise God. Some of these sad faces might need to fast, huh? We got to get rid of his sad face, because the scripture says God, what? He delights in the what? In the, amen, the praises of his people.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is a day that we ought to be standing tall.
Yes.
Standing tall. Okay, Romans 10. I just want you to look at that, beginning at the... Romans 10. Verse 11, it says, for the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Let somebody say, if you believe on Christ, if you fear him, if you fear him, you'll never be what? You'll never be ashamed. Whosoever believeth on him shall never be what? Ashamed. That's for the sinner, also for the what? Saint alike. Whosoever believeth, say that again. Whosoever believeth on him shall never be what? Amen. To the sinner, the Lord says, repent and believe. That's what he said for the sinner. Repent and believe. Then the Lord said what? You won't be ashamed. You won't be ashamed. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be what? Saved. Okay, the next verse says this. Read it, help me. But there is no what? Difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich. I'm going to just magnify God is rich unto what? All that call upon him, right? For whosoever shall what? Call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. All right, so the Bible says God is rich. Rich. Now, I just want you to understand that many times people look upon God as being able. Amen. God is able. How many know God is able to heal?
Amen.
How many know God is able to save?
Amen.
How many know God is able to keep you from falling?
Yes.
How many know that God is able to perfect that which you have committed unto him?
Yes.
Alright, but let me just go a little step further. Amen. Knowing God is able, God has the power, God has the ability, does not do a whole lot for your faith. Amen. So the healer is able, but you better know if she's willing. Amen. She's able to get up at, amen, 6 o'clock in the morning and cook biscuits from scratch. She's able. Sister, you don't need me to talk to her. But is she willing? Is she willing? Oh, better answer for herself. Right. All right. Now I'm gonna take it further. She probably would be willing if I would, you know, kind of baby her up and do some nice things and promise her something real nice. But knowing God is willing, knowing God is willing is good, it's great, because it takes you a little further than just knowing that a person is what? Able. That's good in that respect. But yet, that word willing is kind of, is too tame to really express God's love, or God's compassion, or God, the degree that God is willing toward us. So, if you want to put it on a higher plane, you want to say that God is not able, God is not just what? Willing, but God is what? More than willing. We call it, he is full of eager yearning. He wants to do it what? For you. He's willing to do it, and he wants to do it real bad. Everybody say real bad.
Real bad.
Amen. That takes you past what? Just being what? Willing. Amen. So when we think about God being rich in mercy, rich in compassion, rich in grace, that means that God is willing, but the scripture says he's able to do exceeding abundantly above what? All that you can what? Think or what? Ask. God wants to do whatever you need him to do more than what you really want him to do. Now, if you can convince people that God is full of eager yearning, he wants to do for them what they want him to do it, and he wants to do it what? Really bad, then you can take that person up to a higher level of faith. Amen. So the scripture has to convince people that God is not just able, but God is what? More than able. The scripture has to convince people that God is not just willing, but he is what? More than what? Willing. God is full of what? Eager yearning. He wants to work in your life. He wants to heal you. He wants to bless you more than you what? Really desire the blessing. He wanted more than you can ever imagine. He is what? Full of what? Mercy. Full of compassion. Hallelujah. So one thing you can say, God is really for me. Somebody say, God is for me. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Now, the scripture, go back to Romans 8. I want you to see this, that the scripture that I referred to last week, Romans 8:32, it says this. Verse 31, everybody with me. What shall we say to these things? If God be what? Alright? Who can be against us? Now, I said earlier, grace is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. That includes all of the mercies. Somebody said God's grace is sufficient. Is that right? Where sin abound, grace doth what? Much more. But God can what? Wipe out sin, and you'll never know how free and, amen, praise God, and how released from that sin you could ever really be. Because where sin abound, grace doth what? Much more. How many know that God's power, God's love, amen, is a jillion times more than Satan's, amen, hate against you, right? God is for me. Tell yourself, God is for me.
God is for me.
So it shouldn't be hard for us to receive what we want from God. When we can convince ourselves that what? God is what? For me. God wants me to receive whatever I need more than what? What? Amen. Than what I want to, amen. That was what I want to receive. Amen. He wants to do it even in a greater measure. Okay, look at verse 32. Everybody together. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Now, look here. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Freely. 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 Everybody just said freely. Give us freely. God wants to what? Freely give us whatever we want, need. Amen. Praise God. See, the problem is not with God. Amen. God ain't a tight-fisted God. God is what? He is for us. He wants to release. He wants us to be blessed more than we ever could what? Imagine. Amen. But the thing is that, amen, we have to what? We have to what? We have to want it. We have to accept it. We have to what? Believe it. Hebrews 11:6 says, without what? Faith, it's impossible to what? Please him. For those that come to him must first what? Believe. And that he is a what? Rewarder of them that will what? Diligently seek him. All right, so that scripture lets you know that God can bless us. The reason why he is so eagerly desirous of blessing us is because of what he has already done for us through Christ. That is the basis of every mercy, every blessing, every kindness, every thing that God has provided us. That's the basis of us receiving any. That's the reason why God can freely do it. Because Jesus has already what? Amen. God has already what? Offered up his what? His son. In other words, for us to get back into a position where we were before we sinned, man sinned, amen, man has to be what? Reconciled. He has to be brought back into a position where the blessings can what? Be released into his what? His life again. And Jesus has what? Paid the price. Amen. Jesus what? Laid down his life. Oh, glory, glory. See, that every hindrance is what? Out of the way. All right, let me just show you this scripture here. This really blessed me. 1 John 4, this says here. 1 John 4, it says this. And this was manifested, the love of God toward us. This is 1 John 4, verse 9. In this, everybody say in this, was manifested the love of God toward us. Because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might what? Live through him. See, we have to place ourselves in a position for God to what? Release these mercies and these blessings. So you have to listen to what the scripture is what? Saying. Sometimes our patience is very what? Short. The only way you can actually come to the point where God's grace or God's compassion can really begin to be released into your life, you have to what? Follow along with the what? The word of God. Amen. Sometimes our what? Minds kind of float in and they do what? Float out. Faith comes by what? Hearing. Turn to somebody and say, wake up. Faith comes by what? Hearing. See, when people came to Jesus, the reason why, I'm going to give you this little nugget. The reason why Jesus could heal everybody that came to him, guess what, praise God, he did. What was always magnified? His love, his mercy, his compassion. Amen. In other words, he let people know that I want to do this for you, and I want to do it, what? Real bad. But you're going to have, they came to what? Hear him. They came to what? Hear him, and to be what? Healed of all of their diseases. Amen. So you're going to have to what? Hear this. You're going to have to hear about God's willingness. You're going to have to, amen, you're going to have to be convinced through the words from scripture after scripture, just like the one that I'm getting ready to share with you now. Everybody together. And this was manifested, the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might, what? Live through him. That's the reason why God sent Jesus, so that we might what? Live. Jesus said, I come that you might have what? Life. And that you might have what? Life more abundantly. Amen. Verse 10. Herein is love. Everybody read with me. Herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he what? Loved us. And sent his what? Son to be the propitiation. All right, let's read it again. Herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he what? Loved us. And sent his son to be the what? See, when we were dead in trespasses and sin, amen, Christ what? Came. When we were dead in trespasses and sin, that's when he what? He came into this love. You didn't have to measure up. You didn't have to get right first. It was because of his what? Because of his love. Amen. We didn't love him, but he what? He loved us. And he sent his only begotten son into the world that we might what? Live through him. So we have a right to life. We have a right to be free. We have a right to be delivered. We have a right to be strong. We have a right to be victorious. We have a right to be a devil overcomer. Amen. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the what? Word of our testimony. God is for me. Touch somebody and just say, God is for you. Amen. He said, Jesus said what? Come down here to become a propitiation. In other words, an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Amen. How many know what Jesus went through to make all of these blessings and provisions possible? How many of you would have liked to have gone through what Jesus went through? How many of you, praise God, would like to have been beaten with 39 stripes, 468 lashes on your back? Bleeding, beaten bloody. But the scripture says he was wounded for our what? Transgression. And he was bruised for what? Our iniquity. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are what? He paid a price. The scripture says he paid the utmost farthing. Amen. To release us. Everybody said to release us. To release us from what? Satan's dominion. Amen. When he said it is finished, when he stripped Satan of his power and his ability to hold us in bondage, amen, he pushed back the forces of what? Hell. The Bible says he spoiled principalities. These are high-ranking demonic forces. He spoiled them. He defeated them. He brought them to naught. And the Bible says, triumphing over them that were in it. Well, the third day he came forth. He had stripped them. Amen. And praise God. And praise God. And completely annihilated and praise God and defeated the works of hell. He came forth. I am he that was dead, but now I'm alive. And I'm alive forevermore. And if I could give you some idea as to what a person, the price he paid, Jesus had to pay a great price. If I could just give this illustration, if any person died outside of the ark of safety, they would have to go to pay the price that Christ paid for themselves. They would have to go and pay for their sins. Amen. How many would like to pay that price? The price for sin is very severe. If a person dies without Christ, his spirit goes to hell, and that spirit and soul is tormented in hell until they are released from hell. I don't think anybody here would want to experience the torments of hell. Amen. Your spirit and soul, your body will be in the grave, but your spirit and soul will be what? Tormented. And the Bible says that there's weeping and what? Gnashing of what? Teeth. Because the pain and the agony and the travail is very great. That's what you have to experience immediately. Amen. When the rich man in hell lifted up his eyes, he was in flames. He was being tormented. Amen. The Bible says where the worms never die. I don't know whether y'all like worms or maggots or snakes and things of that nature, coiled serpents and things of that nature. But the Bible speaks about all of these things being in the region of the damned. Amen. How many don't want to go to hell for sure? But when the resurrection of the unjust takes place, then they rise from death, from hell, and what happens is that they are given another body. A body that will not ever deteriorate. They will actually experience a physical body again. Everybody that ever died, you'll get a body again. Who was that joke says a man died, shall he live again? The answer is what? Yes. Alright, then you're going to be physical, you're going to be spirit and soul, and then you will stand before the what? Some said judgment seat, but unbelievers do not stand before the judgment seat. Amen. They stand before what? The white throne. Everybody said the white throne. Alright. Then, in body form, spirit and soul, in your body, you're going to be cast into a lake of fire. Amen. That will never cease to burn you up. So that will be jillions and jillions and jillions of years. I mean, if you can think of the Pacific or Atlantic Ocean just being lit with fire, you can kind of get an idea as to the misery that awaits people that are not saved, that won't obey God. Okay, now, can you imagine what Jesus must have experienced? Now, he experienced what every human being will experience if they miss heaven and experience the lake of fire, hell and the lake of fire. The torment, the pain, the agony that Jesus must have gone through in order to pay the price for every human being on the face of the earth. So just think of one person suffering throughout all eternity from the scenario that I just described to you. How do you think it felt when Jesus became sin for us? All of our sins were laid on him. He became sickness for us. Then he had to go and bear that what? Pay the price for the what? Entire human race. If it was any way close to being as bad as what one person experienced, multiplied by every person that ever sinned, the entire human race, you can see that it was a big deal that Jesus did when he became what? Sin for us, and when he what? Was offered up for our sins, when he was wounded for our transgressions, and when he went underneath the earth to pay the price in full for every human being that would ever live. You can understand the price that he paid. Now, with a price of that nature, of that magnitude, why would he want to hold back anything from you? Scripture says if God didn't hold back his only son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not what? With him and through him freely what? Give us all things. How bad did God want us to receive the provisions that he had what? Paid a great price for? The scripture says greater love has no man than the love that he had for us. Willing to what? Lay down his life. Bible says God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, so that whosoever believeth in him shall not what? Perish, but have what? Everlasting life. God wants you what? Saved. God wants you what? Blessed, because he's paid for it. Hallelujah. He became sin for you. He became what? Sickness for you. He destroyed what? Satan's power for you. He suffered the just for the unjust. To make it possible for us to be what? Able to step up to the put Satan out of business. I've already, praise God, hallelujah, suffered for the unjust to bring you to God. Amen, praise God. Hallelujah. Greater love hath no man than the love that he had for us, to lay down his life for his friends. How many can say amen? How many know that God wants those blessings to be what? Freely flowing into your life. He ain't trying to hold back nothing. It wouldn't make sense for him to go through all of that and then trying to what? Hold back. Satan comes to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I am come that you might what? I want you to have it. 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 I want you to be blessed. I want you to be saved. I want you to be healed. I want you to have a full package. Because what? I have already what? Laid down my life. I paid the price. I have suffered more than any person could ever conceive in their mind. He ain't trying to hold back nothing. I tell you that. All right. Turn to 1 Chronicles. Amen. 2 Chronicles. Let me see. Is it 1 Chronicles 16 and 9? You see that God is not trying to hold back nothing. He wants you blessed more than you ever could conceive of how much he wanted you to be blessed. 1 Chronicles 16. 2 Chronicles 9. I want you to read this with me. Now here's how you get convinced that God is eagerly desiring. In other words, he is really desiring to shower you or to release into your life the abundance of provisions and blessings that he has what? Paid for and made accessible and available to you. 2 Chronicles 9:16. I want you to just turn. See, this is how you get your faith built and see. Okay, 2 Chronicles 16:9. Okay. All right, the first scripture I gave you was Romans 8:32. Is that right? And now I'm giving 1 John 4, verses what? 9 and 10. All right, those are scriptures that need to be meditated because these are scriptures that enable you to see that God is more than willing to release into your life whatever you are seeking from him. He's not just willing, he's what? More. He's eagerly desiring. He wants to do it more than you want it done. And once you can get to a point where you are convinced that God wants to do it more than you want to, amen, want him to do it, the blessing is going to what? The blessing is going to be released. Hallelujah. All right, 2 Chronicles 16, now everybody together, what does that say? All right, come on, everybody say what? Say it again, you guys. Are running what? All right, now, this might not mean that much to very many of you. But it shows how eagerly, how desirous, how bad. Ooh. Oh, his eyes are what? Running. All right, just turn around this way. Let your eyes run. His eyes are what? Running. To him, he's just searching for the heart, the person who will what? A person that will let him do what he what? Wants to do. A person that's open, a person that's willing to submit to his plan. So you gotta accept it, you gotta believe it, you gotta get the word. Everybody that Jesus healed, for the most part, they came to what? Hear him. Amen. Everybody said, you gotta settle down and what? Amen. And get some what ears that can what hear. You gotta hear. You gotta let these scriptures what soak in. You gotta let these scriptures convince you that God is what? He's eagerly desirous of what? Really blessing you because he's full. Everybody say he's full. Everybody say he's full. He's full. Amen. He's just looking for someone to dump it out on. But that heart has to be what? That heart has to be what? Open. That heart has to be, amen. It has to be a heart that will commit him. You're the one that have to what? Set the tone or set the stage for God's blessings to what? To flow. Amen. And how do you do that? You do it by what? Hearing. Touch somebody and say, you gotta hear. Amen. Praise God. So say, he'll say, you gotta hear and what? Obey. You gotta do whatever he says, what? Do. Amen. Praise God. All right. Now, the other scriptures, Michael, let's turn there just for a second. Michael 7. Okay, everybody read that. See, full of eager, God is full of eager yearning. Hallelujah. He's full, he wants to do it, and he wants to do it really, really, really bad. Amen. Now, Michael 7:18, what does that say? Everybody together. Michael 7:18, that might be one of those scriptures that's kind of difficult to find. Now, what page is that on? All right, next to Jonah, all right, Michael. Everybody, I got Jonah, Michael. 7:18, everybody together, let's read it now. All right, see somebody not reading that. See, there's a message here. Who is a God like unto what? Thee, that pardoneth what? Iniquity, and passes by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage. He retaineth not his anger forever, because he delighteth in mercy. So God, you can get by whatever hindrance you have. You can get by sin, because he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. But you got to be willing to release everything in your life that's not pleasing to God. Amen. That's what God is looking for. He's looking for a person that's willing to release everything in their life that's hindering his compassion and his mercy and his love and his grace from what flowed into them. That's what he's looking for. Amen. That got real quiet then. Because he delighted. Everybody say he delighted. He what? Delighted. He rejoices. And he wants to do it more than you want it done. The only thing is that what? He just wants you to take out the what? The hindrance. Behold, I stand. I'm standing at the door of your heart. Amen. It might be some attitude. Something that you have against somebody. It was a lady that came up for prayer, and 63 out of 65 people got healed before, amen, doing that prayer line. And she was a person that she had stolen some money from a relative. And the minister said, I see dollar bills in your eyeballs. Word of wisdom. And when she went and made restitution and paid back that money that she had stolen from her relative, he came and she came back and he laid hands on him and she got her healed. It was one sister that was in the land. She had just stolen something from a department store, and he saw that she had stolen something. And when she went and made restitution, laid hands were laid on her, then she was healed. See, God is looking, his eyes are running to and fro. He's looking for that heart that have removed every hindrance. How many know that? Amen. Sometimes attitude towards somebody, unforgiveness. There are many things that can hinder God's compassion from being what? Released into your life. So God, so his eyes are running. Amen. Bible says, don't withhold good from them to whom it is due when it's in the power of your hands to do it. How many believe that that can cause a blessing to be withheld? Somebody touch somebody and say, withholding can prevent the blessing. Oh, hallelujah. Okay, here's the prosperity. I'm going to stop on this one. Psalms 35, 27. Amen. Psalms, here's the one that pertains to prosperity. See, God wants to do these things. It's already been provided through Christ 2,000 years ago. Your blessings were paid for. Settled and sealed. All things are yours. He's given you everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness. He's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. He's redeemed us from the curse of the law. We're already healed. We're already saved. We're already blessed. We're already delivered. The work is already done. Yes. What's the problem? God is looking for, amen, praise God, those whose what, hearts are open, those that will permit him, those that will, amen, push back and pull out every what, hindrance that will remove anything that will prevent the blessings from flowing freely. All right, Psalms, what did I say? Let's read that together. Psalms 35. All right, come on, Psalms 35, 27. All right, let's say it again. Psalm 35, 27 says what? All right, come. Well, y'all sure have heard that. Let them what? Shout. That's the first thing that will keep a lot of people from what? From receiving. They ain't gonna shout. It says, shout for joy now. See, it's gonna take some shouting and opening up to get rid of the devil's hold over your life. That's the reason why a lot of times people are not going to get nowhere in receiving blessings, because what? Many times their hearts are not quite in a position. It's going to take what? Opening your mouth and letting go. Amen. Praise God. And blessing the Lord with everything you have. Amen. And then you'll see, amen, something begin to what happen. He said, he'll forgive all your iniquities. He said, but when you do it with all, y'all don't get that. When you do it with what? All that's within you. Shout for joy. Amen. See, if everybody would stop shouting, them shackles, those hindrances, oh, that undoubt, that unbelief, all of those spirits and, oh, God, and attitudes and all this mess that keeps us down, broke, poor, distressed, discouraged, mad. Hallelujah. Praise God. These forces would be broken over your life. So that's just what the scripture says. God has pleasure in the prosperity of his what? Servant. God has pleasure. Should have been cut off. Amen. And even, I believe it's Luke 12, 32, is God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. He wants, ooh, glory. He wants to bless you more than you want to be blessed. He wants to bless your socks off of you. He wants to give you everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness. He wants to what? Amen. To make your life full and complete.
Amen. Yes, Lord. Amen.
Okay, now here's the qualifying command. It says what? Let them what? Shout. Let them say. Let them what? All right. Take somebody and say, you got to shout. You got to lift up your voice.